finding myself at a loss for words. And the funny thing is that it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, hear your voice. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain?
Good morning. It is a beautiful day. It's a little rainy. I got some snow on the ground. It's a little dreary, but that's okay. It's a beautiful day where two or more are gathered. God is with us, and we are two or more. It is good to be with you this morning. Welcome to Grace. My name is Drew. I'm the pastor here at Grace, and we're so glad to have you in worship this morning. I'm coming at you from my home office. Our church is downtown in beautiful Greensboro. I am just outside of downtown, upstairs in the home office. It is good to be with you this morning. Please do say hello as you're signing on, and please do check in. It's just a great way to have kind of a digital greeting. Good morning, Karen and Melinda and James Austin. Hey, Samantha. Hey, Owens. Is good to see y'all. Please, others do say hello as we're beginning this morning. It is good to be with you. Today is a special day. We are continuing our series called Precedented. We're looking at those classic practices of faith that following such an unprecedented year, there are things that we can rely on to encounter God and to grow in grace. I'm excited to continue that this morning. We also got a really special children's moment. I'm not going to give any spoilers. It's kind of different, but it's really, really cool. And I'm excited to share that with you this morning. If you're new to Grace and wondering what we're about is embracing all people with God's love, empowering disciples to follow Jesus, and engaging with our neighbors as servant leaders. That's the journey that we believe God has called us to, and we're glad to have you as part of that journey today. If you are joining us and you're new with us, on the description of the YouTube video here, there is a link to a guest form. We'd love for you to fill that out. It's very brief. We're not going to give your information away. We're not going to message you, email you, unless you request that. If you want to be part of our email list, there's a place on that to mark that. We're not going to bother you. We'd love just to get to know you a little bit better and be able to greet you properly and connect with you. So thanks for doing that. Good morning, Gracie and Joe. Hey, Sylvia. Hey, Sugar. Good morning, Patty. Good morning, Wrights. Good to see y'all this morning as well. Friends, let's begin this morning with sharing a couple of things that are going on in the life of our community. We've got Valentine's Day coming up, and we've got two ways to share God's love this Valentine's Day. The first of those is a mobile blood drive with One Blood. That's our local blood bank. They provide most of the blood to the Cone Health System, so it's neighbors serving neighbors. You see the sponsor code there. It's also in your weekly email, the link to that. It'll be most of the day on the 15th. It's a great way to give the gift of life. One donation can save up to three lives. So thank you for that in advance. Y'all have been very faithful with blood drives, and I think it's cool to have one around Valentine's Day. Secondly, we're going to be blessing the teachers that are in our congregation. We have a lot of educators that are part of our community, and we want to make sure that they have the supplies they need as some of our students are going back into the classroom. A lot of our teachers are having to buy their own supplies. And so we want to help out. Children's size, disposable masks, hand sanitizer, disinfectant wipes, tissues, bless some teachers with some gift cards, save them from having to cook some nights, when they're grading and all that stuff. We just want to really bless the teachers that are part of our community. There's a whole lot of teachers, of course. We want to make sure the ones that are part of Grace are well taken care of. That's a great place to start. So, there's more about that in the weekly email. Thanks to Joe for putting these together. We are going to resume our Zoom fellowship. It's going to be moving to the first and third Sundays, picking up next Sunday, February 7th. So we will look forward to that. Good morning, Will. Good morning, Karen. And good morning, Jane Long. Jane is listening to us over the phone. And Jane, it's good to have you join as well. So thanks so much for saying hello. Today we're going to be looking at the power of Scripture, how the Bible shapes us and brings us into God's story. But as we worship this morning, what we're just trying to do is be with God, to encounter Jesus. And so our opening song this morning is, Lord, I Lift Your Name on High. Awesome. Thanks so much to Tom and Vaughn and Jacob for sharing their gifts with us. Good morning, Don and Scott. Don Wright noticed something sparkling on Vaughn's hand. Vaughn and Derek did get engaged recently, and a big congrats on that. I'm pretty sure that's That's public now. So congrats to Vaughn and Derek, and prayers for their next steps as they build a family. Good morning, Shannon and the Martin crew. Good to see y'all as well. We're entering now into a time of prayer. Let me share some prayer requests with you, as well as some praises, just to make you aware and add to your prayers today and in the week to come. We continue to pray for the McKay family and their loss of Caleb. They're away getting some downtime into the beach this week. Continue just to pray for them and support them. It'll be a difficult time for them, as of course we all know. Continue prayers also for Marjorie, who's recovering from surgery. Also prayers for traveling mercies for Char and her daughter Lindsay. They're traveling. Lindsay's had some lingering pain issues in her legs, and they're hoping to get some answers about that at an out-of-state hospital. So prayers for them as they travel this weekend. Prayers also for Heather's mom, who's out of the hospital now and is doing some rehab before coming home. And also for Jeff Lang. Jeff tested positive for COVID, but he's doing well. And so we're grateful for that, and just prayers. Heather's doing a lot of caregiving. They're doing a lot of caregiving in her family. So prayers for them. And I'm sure you know others that are sick or have been sick or caring for others who are sick. We pray for, an end to the pandemic. And we're grateful that people are getting vaccinated. We pray that speeds up and continues. Also prayers, I want to name a couple of families in our church that are getting ready to add a new addition. We want to lift up Samantha and Catherine, who are both due with new babies in the next few weeks. So prayers for Samantha and Catherine, their families, as they prepare to welcome new life to their families as well. I'll turn it over to Joe now. Joe's going to have our opening prayer this morning. Thanks, Joe, for your ministry among us.
Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, we thank you for this day and for the many blessings that you've given us. Lord, we thank you that even on the coldest and darkest nights, you're our light and our warmth. And we thank you, Lord, that we have the hope of spring, the hope of Easter, and the joy of your Son's resurrection, which has given us eternal life. Lord, we ask that in this time of worship that you would draw close to us and help us to draw close to you. And we pray, Lord, that you would hear the prayer requests that are on our hearts, Lord. Those things that we've said aloud, that we've mentioned to others, and those that we keep buried in our hearts. We ask that you would receive those things now and hold them in the palm of your hand. And Lord, we ask that you would help us to stay safe and healthy each and every day. And Lord, we pray for the scientists and the doctors and all of those that are on the front lines and that are preparing vaccines. We pray that those will start to be rolled out quickly. And Lord, we pray that we would be able to be together again soon. We ask all these things in the glorious name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thanks so much, Joe. And Elizabeth, I agree with you. It's nice to have some things to celebrate this morning and welcoming some new life into our community. Good morning, Pam. Good to see you. And Melinda, I'm with you. I love that song. I got a couple songs this morning that I've been singing since I was a kid, and I'm excited to hear them and share them. We'd like to invite our children to gather a little bit closer. It's their time this morning. We've got a very special children's moment this morning that I'm very excited about. So we'll get right to that. And then one of our children is going to pray for us this morning as well. So here we go.
What you doing?
Reading the Bible.
Any questions?
Yes, actually, one. I was wondering,
how God actually wrote the Bible. Because I know God is everywhere, but he doesn't really have hands. So how did he write this book?
Well, you see, God didn't actually write the Bible. His words kind of did, because they inspired the people who actually wrote it, like Mark, Luke, Moses, John, and Daniel.
Kind of like the burning bush?
Exactly.
So God sent the messages, and then the people actually wrote them down.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like, write this down. God loves everyone. The reason I wanted you to write that down is because you wrote that down, but the word actually came from me. That's how the Bible worked.
Gotcha. So lots of people wrote the Bible. They did the writing, but it was all inspired by God and his word.
Yeah.
Hey, Sophie. Do you want to tell everybody that God loves us all?
Do you want to, Sophie?
Do you want to?
No.
Okay. God definitely loves us all. And we know that for sure because the Bible says so.
Have a good Sunday, everybody. And now here's Bo with our prayer.
Dear God, thank you for your loving word. All God's people say, amen.
Awesome. Great job, everyone. Thanks, Bo, for praying for us. Thanks to Elizabeth and Ava and Sophie, of course, for that. That was really good. And it actually goes perfect with what we're talking about today as well. So really, really cool. Thanks so much for that. That's really special. Thanks to Samantha for arranging those as well. That's awesome. Thanks to everyone who's giving of your gifts in different ways, your presence here, sharing as part of our music ministry, or praying, or reading scripture, donating to the good things that we're trying to be a part of in our community, the Zoe offering, things of that nature. Thanks for sending your checks or setting up your auto draft, giving online, however it is you're giving of yourself to God's ministry through grace. We are grateful for that. Today we're going to talk a lot about the gift of Scripture. The gift of Scripture. And one way of thinking about Scripture is that it's the words of life. There's a lot of words in our world, ugly words, nasty words, but in Scripture we have the wonderful words of life. That's our next song. awesome. Thanks so much to Katie and Elizabeth and Chris for sharing their gifts with us. Lots of compliments here on the chat for Bo and for the Owens girls, and I would second all of those. Good morning, Darren. Good morning, Glasgow. It's good to see y'all this morning as well. Friends, let's pray together. Now I invite you to join me with the words on the screen, and let's pray together for our offering prayer. God of wonder and glory, we thank you that you are not hidden. In your Son, through your Spirit, and the witness of your saints, you are made known to us. Especially we praise you for Scripture. So often we have taken this gift for granted. Sometimes we are confused by your silence, forgetting that we have neglected to seek you in its pages. Teach us to honor the Bible, not in theory, but in practice, not as an heirloom of ancient faith, but as a living source of your grace. Inspire our reading and meditation, and so draw us nearer to your life. In a world desperate for truth, in a culture confused and busy, teach us to slow down, sit, and seek you in these books, given life by your very breath. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, and all God's people said, Amen. Amen. Friends, this morning we're continuing a series called Precedented. After an unprecedented 2020, and sometimes it feels like 2020 just sort of continued, we'll go there. We are looking in this series at practices that are timeless, at practices that are paths, you might say, that are well-worn, that we can trust to grow us in grace, to encounter God's love, practices that have sustained God's people for generations. We've looked at silence and prayer, which of course go nicely together. And today we're turning to Scripture, to the Bible, to these wonderful words of life that God has given to us. So we're gonna turn to Scripture in just a moment. Tim's gonna read for us, but I'm gonna just make a little offer, make a little note. I haven't done this before, and it just occurred to me to try because we're not gonna have our fellowship after worship today. And what I'm talking about is a big topic that I can't do justice to in, you know, 15 or 20 minutes, let's be honest, probably 20 minutes. So what I thought I would do is maybe a brief Q&A after worship. So if you have questions you'd like to ask about the Bible, you can put those in the comments. And after the postlude at the very end, I'll stick around for a few minutes. And if there's questions, I'll be happy to have kind of a conversation about those just here still on the live stream. So I know folks have to go get lunch, things like that. I'm not telling everyone to stick around, but if you have some questions, put them in the chat, and I'll do my best to answer those briefly after worship. So if you want to stick around for a little Q&A about the Bible and its place in our lives, how to read Scripture, maybe how to find the right study Bible, whatever it is, stick around for a few minutes after worship. We'll have a little bit of Q&A. If you want. We'll see if anyone wants to. We might all go home early, but just wanted to offer that this morning. I'm grateful for all the folks that read Scripture for us, and it's so nice to have a diversity of voices here as part of our worship. Thanks so much to Tim for reading Scripture for us this morning.
Hello, my name is Tim Jenkins, and today's Scripture is from 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14 through 17. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have known the sacred writings that are able to instruct you for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient and equipped for every good work. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thanks so much, Tim. Let's pray. Blessed Lord, who has caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant us so to hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Savior, Christ Jesus, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. I want to open this morning with a question. Who decides what is true anymore? Who decides what is true anymore? We often hear phrases repeated like, you are entitled to your own opinion, but not your own facts. But that just begs the question, doesn't it? Who decides what's an opinion and what is a fact? Some claim that we are in an increasingly postmodern world. And in a postmodern world, which is in some ways might be a post-truth society, some fear that there is nothing but interpretation. And even more cynically, some claim that all interpretation is driven by power. There is no truth, there is only those who twist it for their own power. Are we in a post-truth society? And if so, what does it mean to follow Jesus and trust the Bible in a world that trusts no authorities outside of the self? Our world constantly tells us that you can have your truth, I can have my truth, but of course the implication is that no one has the truth. No one has capital T truth. How do you build a society, a community, a family, or a church without some concept of how to arrive at a shared truth? How does your truth versus my truth not end up in what Thomas Hobbes called a war of all against all? Christians claim that the Bible is our guide to truth, at least our guide to the deepest truths. But Scripture is quoted by the left and the right. It's quoted by the radicals and the fundamentalists. It's quoted by Martin Luther King Jr. and white nationalists. How can something used for so many divergent and opposite causes be useful for us today? How can we understand it as something that is true and valuable for us? Paul's letter to Timothy is so helpful here. Paul lived in a world that was rapidly changing. Empires were rising and falling. The Roman Republic had fallen within the last 50 years of Paul's writing. There was a major Jewish revolt that was not far off that would change the shape of Jewish religion forever. Paul himself had gone from being a zealous persecutor of the church to its most effective evangelist and church planter. Paul also has a young protege. What do I mean by a protege? How do I describe this relationship? I think the best answer is Star Wars. In the Star Wars universe, if you're not familiar, Jedi have apprentices that are called Padawans. So a famous example of this is Qui-Gon in the very first episode of Star Wars, Episode 1. Qui-Gon's apprentice is Obi-Wan, who of course gets more screen time in later films. So this is what an apprenticeship looks like in Star Wars. But Paul's Padawan learner, his apprentice, was Timothy. And we have two letters in the New Testament from Paul to his apprentice, Timothy. And these are especially important letters for young people, for children and youth and young adults, and for people who are wanting to raise up and mentor young people in the faith. Near the end of the second letter from Paul to Timothy, he encourages Timothy with these words. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. We'll stop there at verse 15 for now. Notice that Paul is not urging Timothy to do something new or different. He's urging Timothy to stay faithfully on the path he's already on. He notes that Timothy has become convinced because he says, you know those from whom you learned it. In verse 15, Paul says that Timothy has known the Scriptures from infancy. Now that tells us a couple of things. First, we actually know who Paul's talking about here, because in chapter 1 of this letter, Paul specifically mentions Timothy's grandmother named Lois and his mother named Eunice, and he credits Timothy's spiritual maturity in part to their, what Paul calls their sincere faith. So Timothy seems to have been raised in a Christian household, at least a Christian grandmother and mother. It's a wonderful reminder of how we learn what to believe from those closest to us. Of course, that can be for better or for worse. But what we learn is often passed down. Even as much as we like to think that we think for ourselves, a lot of what we think comes from the people closest to us. And so Paul is urging Timothy to continue deepening the faith that he first learned at home from his grandmother and from his mother. Second, when Paul compliments Timothy on knowing the scriptures from infancy, let's be clear on what the scriptures are that Paul and Timothy are talking about. They're talking about what we call the Old Testament. Paul's writing in the first century, and he has no idea as he's writing that his words are going to one day be considered scripture by the church that he is building. The New Testament, as we know it, would not be fully canonized into a list of authoritative books for a couple of hundred years. And so the scripture that Timothy had learned would have been the same scriptures that Paul had learned as a Jew in his background. And those are the books that we call the Old Testament, sometimes also called the Hebrew Bible. Now, we'll talk more about what it means to apply this teaching in the New Testament to also the Old Testament as well. But first, I want to look at one more thing. When Paul says to Timothy that Scripture is able to make him wise unto salvation in Jesus Christ, he's talking about the Old Testament. So often Christians ignore the Old Testament. And I understand there's parts that are difficult or challenging or sometimes hard to get into. But here we're told that these scriptures, the Old Testament, the law, the prophets, all those wonderful writings, that they guide our salvation in Jesus, even though they don't directly mention Jesus. It's an important reminder for us that the Old Testament as well as the New are written for our guidance in faith. Paul continues in verse 16. All scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Now, I really enjoy that verse in particular. I've said before, I went to a conservative Christian school growing up, and those verses in particular were drilled into us over and over again. I still remember the song that we learned to memorize that particular verse. I'm not going to sing it because that'd be very painful for everyone listening, but it's still rattling around in my head. These are interesting verses and important verses. You know, Paul, who was trained as what we would call a serious biblical scholar of the Hebrew Scriptures, he gives us maybe our best insight into how to understand what the Bible is as a whole. And verse 16 is very important here. The NRSV translation that we're reading from today says, "All Scripture is God-breathed." Now, in the King James and the NIV and other translations, that's often translated to something like, "All Scripture is inspired by God," or inspired of God, something like that, instead of God breathed. Now, this word here is really unique and helpful. The Greek word there is theopneustos, theo God, neustos, breath. Now, this was not a common word in the ancient world. In fact, scholars believe that this is the earliest use that we have anywhere in ancient Greek writing of this word. It was not common. To put it a little different way, to describe the relationship of Scripture to God, Paul had to kind of pull out the dictionary, pull out his thesaurus, and use a very rare word, a word that's used only once in all the letters of Paul that we have. Now, maybe this suggests that the inspiration of Scripture, that the unique authority and message from God that Scripture conveys to us is so special, so powerful, so beautiful, that Paul had to find in some ways some new words even to describe it. God breathed. Christians often say, of course, that Scripture is inspired by the Holy Spirit. And in the Bible, breath and spirit often go together. In Hebrew, the same word for breath means Spirit. So God's breath, God's Spirit inspires. And of course, inspire is a lot like breath also. It is God's Spirit, as we heard in our wonderful children's moment a few minutes ago. It is God inspiring through the Holy Spirit faithful people who wrote down these words that got us the Bible that we have today. Really, really cool. Now, if that's where the Bible comes from, that's great, but what do we do with it? Why did God breathe and inspire these words for us? The short answer is to equip us for what Paul calls good works, to equip us for ministry in the way of God. We might say to equip us for kingdom-shaped ministry. Look again at the end of these verses. All scripture is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness so that the servant of God, that's you and I, remember, we're on a journey to become servant leaders in God's kingdom, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. In other words, scripture is how those of us who serve God know what that service should look like. Now, scripture is not just an instruction booklet. It's the story of God. It's the epic of grace. It's the drama of redemption written over dozens of books spanning hundreds and thousands of years. I would summarize it this way. Scripture is the saga of God that equips the servants of God. Scripture is the saga of God that equips the servants of God. Now, this, of course, brings up a little problem. Winston Churchill once remarked, for instance, that Americans and the British are two people divided by a common language. Unfortunately, the church often seems like a people divided by a common book, by a common Bible. Lincoln said something like this in his second inaugural address when he said about both sides of the Civil War that both read the same Bible and pray to the same God, and each invokes God's aid against the other. Today, and at least in some areas, Christians are just as divided over the meaning of Scripture. And in public arguments, politicians and activists on both the left and the right, in the middle and everywhere else, invoke Scripture to support their causes. So what does it mean to say the Bible is true and trustworthy if there is so little agreement on what it actually means? I think a lot of this comes down to understanding first what Scripture is and what it's about. Because the Bible's not meant to be just a collection of rules or wise sayings, not little things we can pluck out to give us a yes or no on different big questions. It's not a direct guide to dating advice or to public policy. The Bible is, first of all, the story of God. It's a grand epic. It's a saga, as we've said, of God working through imperfect people to redeem and to restore. This saga is not told through one book, but through a collection of books, a library with different authors and genres, different worldviews, different tones, and different ways of conveying God's message. So how did so many diverse voices come to be viewed as one story? How did so many different books come to be considered one authoritative collection of books called the Bible? Well, we've used some resources from the Bible Project before, and they've got a great series on kind of an overview of what Scripture is. So I want to share with you one of their videos on how the Bible came to be collected together.
The Bible. It's one of the most influential books in human history.
It explores the big questions of why we exist.
It's inspired many people to do amazing things.
And confused many others.
And you've probably got one sitting around somewhere.
So, what is the Bible actually?
Well, the Bible is a small library of books that all emerged out of the history of the people of ancient Israel. And in one sense, they were just like any other ancient civilization. But among them were a long line of individuals called prophets, and they viewed Israel's story as anything but ordinary. They saw it as a central part of what God was doing for all humanity, and These prophets were literary geniuses.
Really?
Yeah, they expertly crafted the Hebrew language to write epic narratives, very sophisticated poetry. They were masters of metaphor and storytelling, and they leveraged all of this to explore life's most complicated questions about death and life and the human struggle.
So, there's a lot of different authors writing this book.
Yeah, and these texts were produced over a 1,000-year period, starting with Israel's origins in Egypt, then leading up to their kingdom with their first temple. But eventually, they were conquered by the Babylonians, who took them away into exile. Then, at a crucial moment in their history, many Israelites returned to their land. They built a second temple, they reformed their identity, and this is when the Jewish scriptures began to be formed into the shape that we have them today.
Okay, the Jewish Bible. What's in it?
Well, in Hebrew, it's called by an acronym, Tanakh. The T stands for Torah, sometimes called the Law. That's Israel's five-book foundation story. The N stands for Nevi'im, the Hebrew word for prophets. And this section consists of the historical books that tell Israel's story from the prophet's point of view. Then you get the poetic books of the prophets themselves. The K stands for Ketuvim, the Hebrew word for writings. This is a diverse collection of poetic books, wisdom books, and more narrative. And the Jewish people believe that through all of these literary works, God speaks to his people.
Now, there were other Jewish writings being produced during this Second Temple period as well.
Yeah, a really diverse group of texts. And these two were highly valued in Jewish communities. And there was debate from ancient times about whether or not some of these should be considered part of their scriptures.
So this is a lot of different writings over a long period of time. Why did they put them all together like this?
Well, altogether, these texts tell an epic story about how God is working through these people to bring order and beauty out of the chaos of our world. And it all builds up to a hope for a new leader who would come and renew all creation. And then the Tanakh concludes, and this leader never comes.
So it's an expertly crafted work, but it's missing an ending?
That's exactly right. Now, a few centuries later, a Jewish prophet comes onto the scene named Jesus of Nazareth. He claimed he was carrying the Tanakh story forward.
Yeah, so Jesus did a bunch of cool stuff. Was killed, but his followers claimed he was alive from the dead.
Yeah, they said that Jesus was that long-awaited leader who would restore the world. And so his earliest followers, called apostles, they composed new literary works about the story of Jesus. They called these Good News, or the Gospel. They formed an account called Acts about the spread of the Jesus movement outside of Israel. And then they circulated letters to different Jesus communities all around the ancient world.
And they saw these writings as part of the scripture.
Yeah, the apostles wrote all of this as the fulfillment of that epic story found in the Tanakh. And they were continuing the literary genius of the Jewish tradition. They also believed that God was speaking to his people through these texts alongside the scriptures of Israel.
So that's the Old and New Testament. But what did the early Christians think of the other Second Temple literature?
Well, different groups had different views about some of these books, but we know they read them and valued these texts because they passed them along with the Jewish scriptures.
Okay, so we've got the Tanakh, the Jewish scriptures. We got these other Second Temple period works. Then the writing of the apostles about Jesus. And that's a lot of literature, so what's in my Bible?
So the Christian movement has taken different forms over 2,000 years, and from the beginning, all Christians recognized the Tanakh and the New Testament as scripture. And for centuries, much of the Second Temple literature was read as part of the biblical tradition. The Catholic Church eventually made it official and called some of the books from this collection the Deuterocanonical books. Some Orthodox churches used even more books from this Second Temple literature. And then in the 1500s, during the Reformation, Protestant Christians wanted to go back to the oldest writings of the prophets and apostles, so they accepted only the Old and New Testaments.
Okay, I think I got it. But how does a collection of books produced over 1,000 years by all these different authors tell one unified story?
Yeah, that's the question we'll address in our next video.
I hope you found that helpful and enlightening. I really appreciate their resources. I'd recommend them. They have a whole great series on what the Bible is and how to read it. And they've got particular videos on different books of the Bible, different biblical words. Really, really good stuff. And I've got friends who teach the Bible at the college level, and they use Bible Project stuff. So really any level, age group, level of discipleship, new believers, longtime believers, their stuff is very good. There are two main things I want to make sure that you get from that video. The first is what scripture is, and the second is what scripture conveys. The first, what scripture is. The Bible is a collection of books, not a single book. It's better viewed that, because of that, it's better viewed as a library than as a single book. As you saw in the, and as you saw in the video, different groups of Christians have slight variations on what's in that library. Though all Christians have agreed on the Old Testament as we have it, and the New Testament as most important. And even most Protestants agree that those other books that were named, those other Second Temple books, are helpful and useful for study, but they're not authoritative for our spiritual lives in the way that the other books of the New Testament are. Second, what Scripture conveys. Scripture is chiefly the story of God and God's purposes. It's a love story. It's a redemption story. But I fear that too often we go into Scripture looking for a little Bible McNugget that speaks to this exact moment in my life or the situation in the world. We go to it with hoping for a predetermined answer that fits our worldview, rather than engaging with Scripture on a regular basis and having Scripture shape that worldview. Now, don't get me wrong, the Bible is always relevant to us, and there are times when opening the Bible, looking for a particular answer, the bolt of lightning strikes and God speaks directly through that. That does happen. But I think the Bible is intended to be read as something that is regular and normal and not just in moments of crisis. The Bible's primary purpose is to draw us into God's story, the story of creation and fall, the story of Israel and Jesus, the story of the church, and ultimately the story of God's fulfillment in the kingdom. It is the truth of the world and all of its brokenness and its beauty. And most of all, it's the story of a God who is patient and gracious and seeks to redeem this world in part through faithful women and men empowered by God's Spirit. Scripture is the saga of God that equips the servants of God. But friends, we cannot be equipped by a gift that we never open. The Bible is not an optional part of the Christian life, no more than prayer is optional. Now, it's fair to say that the Bible is not the only thing that Christians spend time on. Let's acknowledge and name that there are people who spend lifetime studying the Bible but aren't transformed by it. There have been racists and bigots who opened the Bible and were not changed by it. And unfortunately, sometimes Christians who talk the most about how important the Bible is are those Christians that are the most embarrassing to the rest of us. But too often those complexities become an excuse to disengage from the Bible rather than go deeper into it. Friends, we are not too sophisticated for Scripture. The Bible is not something that only the fundamentalists care about. The Bible is God's word to all of us. The Bible is a gift and a treasure, and one of the main ways that not only divine wisdom, but God's very presence, God's light and truth, and God's grace is conveyed to us. We call the series Precedented because we're exploring proven pathways to grow closer to God. And there is no disciple who is so advanced. There is no saint who is holy enough. There is no pope who is powerful enough. There is no preacher who is wise enough that they do not need to seek God regularly in Scripture. Scripture is the saga of God that equips the servants of God. So here's my challenge to you. I want to challenge you to encounter Scripture outside of Sunday mornings. Worship has never been intended to be the only time Christians explore Scripture, just as it's not intended to be the only time that Christians pray together. Find ways to add Scripture to your daily life. Now, a word of warning. Here's what I don't want you to do. I don't want you to pick up a Bible tonight and try to read 100 pages. Please don't do that. If you do that, that's great, but I'd rather you start small. Try to find small ways to regularly read and hear and engage Scripture. Don't try to jog before you crawl. If you've not had a Bible reading habit, if you've not encountered Scripture a whole lot, it's okay to start small and start simple. What does that look like? It might just look like reading a chapter of the Bible in the morning as part of your morning routine, or maybe before bed. It might be using an app, something like Pray As You Go or YouVersion that includes scripture. Pray As You Go is a favorite of mine. YouVersion is an app that has multiple translations of scripture that also has the audio version. So you can literally have it read scripture to you while you're driving or whatever you're doing. It's great. Maybe there's a devotional that you can do together as a family at dinner time. Maybe it's time to get involved in a small group or Bible study. Maybe it's time to start one. Maybe it's time to restart one. Keep it simple. Keep it small and commit to it for 30 days. You know, you're on the phone a lot anyway. We're all on our devices and screens. Just make 5 minutes of that daily screen time for starters. Make 5 minutes of that daily screen time, time for engaging scripture. Scripture is the saga of God that equips the servants of God. And friends, there are too many under-equipped disciples out there. This year at Grace is all about inside out, about becoming the disciples we've been called to be. Imagine a church where people are deeply shaped by scripture, shaped by God's story of redemption, instead of the world's story of constant conflict and anger and fear. Imagine a church of youth who are not only well-equipped by their schools with knowledge about important subjects, but are equipped for life by the story of God in Scripture. Imagine a church of children who are learning the story of God from their very first days, who, like Timothy, know the Scriptures from infancy. What kind of kingdom impact will those children grow up to have? Imagine a church where everyone has a Paul who is mentoring them in the faith, and everyone has a Timothy that they are mentoring. Who is your Paul? Who's your Timothy? Friends, we'll never become the disciples or the church that God has called us to be without a deep and sustained engagement with God's story given to us in the Bible. So start small. Make scripture a part of your walk with God. We may be living in a post-truth society, but there is no such thing as a post-Bible church. Scripture is the saga of God that equips the servants of God. Let's pray. Living and loving God, we give you thanks for this living word that you've given us. God, we give you thanks that through this amazing process of inspired authors and communities, you brought together these words of life for us. And we thank you, God, that you join us as we read, that you inspire our reading, that as we read alone, as we read together with others, that your life is opened up to us, your story, who you've called us to be, everything is there. So God, teach us to be a people of this book, a people of this wonderful library. Teach us, God, that in a world where truth is a commodity, where truth is something everyone is selling, where truth is trying to be manipulated, that God, you have given us the truth in these pages. Teach us, God, to approach it with humility, not using it as a weapon, but using it as a guide for our lives. Most of all, God, reveal yourself to us in these pages. And help us to see our part in your grand redemption story. For in Jesus Christ, you are making all things new. And in Scripture, you desire to guide us into the truth of our part of that story. God, for those that used to have a habit of Scripture, but lost that habit maybe during the pandemic or after kids were born or whatever, I pray for rekindled habits. God, for those who've never really engaged Scripture before because it seems intimidating or it seems like something that only the crazy people do, I pray, God, for hearts to be opened up to your word. God, for those longtime saints that have made scripture a part of their regular walk, I pray that you would continue to guide and deepen their reading of scripture. Open them up to new ways of reading, maybe to books they hadn't read or ways they haven't read before. They would continue to grow and find your beauty and truth in those pages. I pray, God, that today begins a new engagement with scripture for the people called to be grace. Let all God's people say, amen. Amen. Friends, as I said at the end of the stream after the postlude, I'll hang around for a few minutes if there's any questions for a little bit of Q&A. You can put questions there in the comments. And of course, if you're not comfortable in that format, you can shoot me an email or a text. You know, if you want to make scripture part of your daily walk with God, I'd love to help you find the right resources for that and be a part of that journey. So any way that I can help that, please just let me know. We're going to close with a beautiful song that reminds us of the truth and beauty of God's word in scripture. Thanks to Melinda and to Faye for this. Awesome. Thanks so much, Melinda and Faye. That is an old favorite of mine. I don't know if it makes sense to call something a contemporary classic, but to me, that song is a contemporary and a classic at the same time. And if you didn't catch the biblical reference, the title of that and the main hook for that song comes from Psalm 119, verse 105, which says, "Thy word is a light unto my feet, a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path." And so I I kept my my green lantern behind me. I got a little light there with the Bible. There's a theme here today. Anyway, thanks so much, Melinda, for your gifts. Friends, we'll draw to a close here in just a moment. We will have a little Q&A after the postlude in just a moment, so stick around for that if you want to. We will have our Zoom fellowship resuming next Sunday after worship, so we'll look forward to that. As we go forth from this time, let's remember the journey that we are on, that our vision is to be a faithful community of servant leaders joining in God's renewal of Greensboro and the world. I hope today that we've seen that part of being those faithful servant leaders and knowing what God is up to in the world is encountering God in God's word in Scripture. Receive now this blessing. In a world of people confused about truth, may we be confident in God. In a world where truth is internal, may we rest in a God who is eternal. In a world that seeks to fill up our time with trivia, may we make time for God's story to become our story. Scripture is the saga of God that equips the servants of God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Alleluia, and all God's people said, Amen. All right. Let's have a little Q&A time. So far, there's only one question, so it might be a short Q&A time, but maybe there's others that will roll in. You can either put it here in the comments or text me if you have a question, and we'll just take a few minutes and address some of those questions. Again, I know I threw a lot at you today, and it's a big, big topic, so I just thought it'd be cool to have a little Q&A time. Mary asked a great question. If we wanted to choose a book of the Bible to start exploring during the month of February, where would you start? I would always start in the Gospels, and probably Mark. Mark is the shortest gospel. In some ways, it's the simplest. It's probably the oldest gospel as well. Matthew and Luke both use Mark in telling their stories, and they add other bits and pieces to it in their own perspective. I would probably start with Mark. Mark is not long. Mark, you know, you can read in a sitting pretty easily. I would probably start with Mark, maybe a different gospel, but I would start in the Gospels. The Gospels are meant to be read as a unit, right? They're kind of like mini biographies of Jesus. So I would start with Mark and then maybe go to other Gospels. Especially with February, we're coming into the season of Lent leading up to Easter. Mark has been described as just one long extended journey to the cross. I think Mark would be a great place to start. Let's see. Tom, are there still manuscripts being found, analyzed, and considered to being added to versions of the Bible, or is the collection complete forever? So it's kind of two ways of answering that. In terms of adding new books to the Bible, most Christians consider the canon — the canon means rule, the collection of approved books — consider that to be closed. And that's simply because with the books that we use now, the 66 books of the Protestant Bible, let's say, are sort of the consensus main books that Christians have used for 1700 years, you know, used beyond that. But in terms of put together in one list that most Christians agreed to, almost all Christians agreed to, that list has been kind of set. Now, there are Christians who would answer the question differently and say God is still inspiring people, and we should be open to that. Others would say — there are scholars who would say that we should consider, for instance, some of the Gnostic Gospels. Every few years, especially around Christmas and Easter, you see these specials come up on TV about the new lost gospel. We just discovered this gospel that's never been found. They're not lost. That's marketing. They're not lost. They were rejected. There's a big difference in something being lost and being rejected. And in most cases, they were rejected because they were not considered to be written by an apostle, by someone that was either directly with Jesus or directly taught by one of Jesus' disciples. Usually they're too late, or they were so wacky that they could not be included. So, for instance, if you were to look at the infancy gospel of Thomas, it's called the — right, just because it's called a gospel doesn't mean it's in the Bible. There's all kinds of gospels written by different groups that are not considered authoritative and were not included, because they were, you know, there are all kinds of competing groups that were not part of the mainstream church that had their own take and their own different things. And the infancy gospel of Thomas is wild. I mean, it's portrays the infant Jesus, like, or the child Jesus, killing people and raising them from the dead, and it's wild. And I always say to people, read those books. There's nothing, you know — I would not try to keep people from exploring those things, but there's a reason they're not in the Bible. And if you read them, it becomes very clear why they're not in the Bible. People like Bart Ehrman make a big deal out of some of those, wanting to say that they should be considered as more mainstream Christian literature. I tend to believe the church was right. Now, the church did say, hey, there's four gospels. There's four different kind of versions of the life of Jesus that matter. But they also rejected a whole bunch, too. So the other way of answering your question, Tom, is that there are still manuscripts being discovered that are ancient copies of books that enhance our current translations. What do I mean by that? Let's put it this way. The number of manuscripts and the quality and the age of the manuscripts that, let's say, the King James Bible translators had 400 years ago is considerably less than what contemporary biblical scholars have today. So actually, over time, our scriptures are getting, in some ways, more and more accurate and reliable to the very oldest texts, because we're discovering still older versions of the Gospel of Mark, or older versions of the Book of Isaiah. A lot of the Dead Sea Scrolls were some of those Isaiah texts and things like that. So if you're in your study Bible, you might see a note that says, some ancient versions say this instead of this. That's the work of scholars to try to figure out, okay, which of these texts is older and which of these was a little bit of change or whatever. So kind of two different ways of answering that question, Tom, but a very good question. I would say the canon is closed. Now, that doesn't mean God's not still inspiring people, but in terms of the authorized canon, that's kind of set. But we are still discovering manuscripts that enable us to better understand those texts. Great question. Scott, did Jesus or the apostles speak Greek? Broad question. How do we think about translation from Jesus' language to the language of the Gospels, or how Jesus' teaching would have been known to Paul? Good question. We actually don't know if Jesus spoke Greek. That's a really good question. A lot of that, that gets into a really hairy question of if you believe Jesus was God in the flesh, which is classic Christian teaching, is there anything Jesus didn't know? Maybe not. But when did Jesus, have access to that divine knowledge? Did Jesus limit himself in some way? It's hard to know that. We don't have evidence in Scripture that Jesus spoke Greek. He would have spoken primarily Aramaic. There are places in the New Testament where Jesus quotes things directly in Aramaic. So we know that. Famously, the Mel Gibson movie, The Passion of Christ, was filmed in Aramaic, right? There are still some places that speak Aramaic. Some of the apostles would have spoken Greek. Greek was sort of in the same way that English is like the standard language of the world in some ways, the language of the majority culture, the language of the marketplace, right? That's English. At another time in world history, it was French, let's say. Today it's English. In this world, it was the Greco-Roman world, right? Israel was occupied by Rome. It was a Roman territory. Greek was kind of the everyday language of people. So we know, for instance, that Paul clearly spoke and wrote in Greek. It kind of depends on, so for instance, the Greek in John's gospel is pretty advanced. The Greek in something like Mark is less so. So scholars will debate on to what level an author was familiar with Greek or not. So some of them were probably written directly by folks that did speak Greek, and some of them were probably oral traditions that communities handed on that were then written in Greek after being handed on in Aramaic. So a really good question. Did I answer all of that? How Jesus's teaching would have been known to Paul? The earliest writings of Paul we have are from the early 50s. The Thessalonian letters are considered to be the oldest of Paul's stuff. So two ways Paul would have known about Jesus. One is in the New Testament, Paul has a direct encounter with Jesus on the road to Damascus. Paul has a vision of Jesus that knocks him down and sends him on a different path. But then Paul is sent to someone in Damascus that kind of disciples him. So Paul was discipled by people in the early church, and then he becomes this discipler and church planter and all that. So, I mean, by the what's really interesting is if you look in 1 Corinthians, there in other letters, Paul quotes things that he clearly learned from other Christians, such as hymns in Philippians chapter 2. There's kind of an early version of a creed in 1 Corinthians 15. And Paul's quoting these things that he would have learned as a new disciple. So in Paul's letters, we have preserved things that the early Christians were already passing on pretty much immediately after Jesus, right? Because if Paul's writing in the 50s and 60s and following, he's writing things that were shared with him, then we've got stuff preserved in the New Testament from right when, right when Jesus is teaching in the first apostles. We also have stuff from the so-called church fathers, some of the earliest Christian writers, who were themselves, like Polycarp, I think, was a disciple of John, the John. We've got writings from Polycarp and stuff like that. So there's some interesting ways of preserving that. Great question. Not about the Bible, but I've wondered about the sign of the cross, why it seems to be more of a Catholic thing, yet I see Protestants like you do it from time to time. Yeah, both Catholic and Orthodox, it's traditional. Episcopalians or Anglicans also do it. And then some weird Protestants like me choose to do it as well. It's essentially, you know, it's both, it's the sign of the cross, right? Makes the shape of the cross. Typically, it's also an invocation of the Trinity, so in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The difference in the Orthodox Church and the Catholic Church is they go different directions. So one cross is left to right, the other goes right to left, and I can't remember right now which one is which, but they cross in different ways. And I think it's sort of an embodied way of remembering God that I think is helpful. And it's something I just sort of do out of habit as well. I think whether you're kneeling, whether you've got your hands open, whether you're, you know, some people when they when the Spirit moves them, they raise their hands in prayer. I think having our bodies involved in prayer and in worship makes a difference. And so I think maybe why it's been a sustained practice is that it's just an embodied way of remembering who God is. And I think in especially Catholic piety, folks will do that when maybe they're concerned about something or they hear an ambulance go by. And it's just another way of, it's just a physical way of remembering God and asking for God's presence. There's nothing, you know, there's nothing that Protestants can't do it. But just kind of a habit that different churches have. Good question. Shannon, the theologian. Yes, good question. The relationship between Scripture as the Word of God and Jesus as the Word of God. Very good question. And Shannon, I'd welcome your thoughts on this too, because you've got the same training I do. So the Gospel of John clearly refers to Jesus as the Word, the Logos, the Word made flesh. In the opening chapters of John, Jesus is referred to as the Word of God. I did a sermon on that not too long ago. So there is a sense in which Jesus is the Word of God from the Gospel of John. Christians also commonly refer to Scripture as the Word of God. Now, there's different ways to go with that. I have had professors who have said to preachers, to those of us preparing to preach, never refer to Scripture as the Word of God. Jesus is the Word of God, not Scripture. And I get that. What they're trying to do is something I agree with, which is make sure that Jesus, right, is placed above the Bible in terms of how we understand who God is. That Jesus is the fullest and final revelation and manifestation of who God is. And I think that's true, and I agree with that. I think there are churches sometimes that in some ways almost idolize the Bible. That sounds weird to say, but it becomes so much about the Bible and not so much about Jesus. I think there can be a weird kind of idolatry of the Bible in some circles. So I think some people make that distinction to avoid that, and I agree with that. I do think, for me, calling Scripture the Word of God, I want to hold on to that in some ways, because it is like special. It is sacred, right? It's not a sacrament, right? We don't use that language to describe the Bible, but it is a narrative through which we encounter God. And so I do want to hold on to, right, and we get that from the Bible. We sang, Melinda sang Thy Word a few minutes ago. We get that from the Bible, this reference to God's Word. There's Scripture that talks about, My Word will not return to me void. It will do what I want it to do, that kind of stuff. So they're both biblical. I don't draw that hard distinction between you must say Jesus is the Word and not the Bible, but I get why people do that. So Shannon, I'd be curious what you think of that answer, and I'd welcome your thoughts on that as well. Sorry, I don't know how to, you know, flip a switch and put you up on video, but please do leave a comment along those lines as well. I thought that was a really good question. Good, good, good. Anything else? This has been fun. I don't want to belabor it. I know people have stuff to do, but if there are other questions, I would take them. If I didn't say anything clearly enough, I would take that as well. Which translation of the Bible is your favorite? I don't know if I have a favorite. That's a really good question, Pam. What I'm used to is the NRSV, the New Revised Standard Version. It's what we use. It's what our lectors use on Sunday mornings, what I typically preach primarily from. There's a lot of good translations. The key is that every translation is always an interpretation. Now, this gets back to Scott's question as well. It's fair to say that, right, something always changes in translation. There's no neutral translation, so let's acknowledge that as well. Going from Aramaic to Greek would be some interesting things happening. What does that mean? Every translation committee has their own point of view. Every individual translator has their own point of view. So the New Revised Standard Version tends to be more of a mainline translation. Methodists, Lutherans, Episcopalians, those folks. There are Catholic translations of Scripture. They're primarily Catholic. The NIV is a great translation, one that I've used a lot of. I grew up more with the NIV. The NIV's translators were more evangelical, not in a, you know, kind of the politicized sense we think of evangelicals today, but just in terms of being mostly probably non-mainline Protestants, slightly more conservative in some ways. The NIV comes from that world. And of course, the King James Version is a classic translation that's still great. I've been through seasons where I've read primarily the King James Version because it's easier for me in some ways to read that sometimes and not get in my head too much, not go into study mode. Probably my favorite, honestly, is the Revised Standard Version, the RSV, the one before the NRSV, because it retains some of that King James language, but it's not quite as stilted. It's updated, but it's not as updated as the New Revised Standard Version. So, I like the RSV. But anyway, that's a long answer to your question. My one encouragement, there are translations that are actually paraphrases. So for instance, The Message by Eugene Peterson. I love Peterson. And I think The Message is very helpful. I would never preach or study primarily from The Message because The Message is more of a paraphrase than a direct translation. Biblical translations run a gamut from word-for-word translations that are trying to be true to the text and thought-for-thought translations that are trying to convey the idea. And The Message is like way over on the thought-for-thought, like so far that it's more of a paraphrase than a translation. But I do refer to it. I find it useful sometimes, even The Message. The Living Bible is popular with a lot of folks. It's a more common language one. There's a Common English Bible now that's come out that's some folks also like. Shannon, great answer. I think it's important for us to wrestle with. I think Jesus' example as the Word fleshed out, who God has translated into human experience. Yeah, and that's great. Yeah. I would second that, Shannon. Thank you for that. That Jesus embodies God's Word. Jesus embodies this message. Hi, Audrey. Good to hear from you as well. Thanks for that. Good stuff. There's still 20 people watching, so if there's other questions, I'm still good to go. So if there's any other questions or thoughts before we conclude, this has been fun. It's kind of fun to be on the spot. And these are great questions. And, you know, I think it's important for us as a community, and I've said this before, but I'm trying to live it out, for us to be a place where you can ask questions, especially hard questions and difficult questions. So if there's questions that you want to ask but don't want to put it on a public live stream, just shoot me a text or an email, and we could have a one-on-one exchange if you prefer. But I think being a church that is open to questions is so important, especially in our world today. So thank you for that. All right, friends, I'm going to say unless there are no other questions that pop up, we will prepare to sign off. Oh, this is Robert. Can you discuss Christocentric interpretation as you read Scripture? Another great theological question. And actually, this is great. I was just talking to some people about this this week. So Christocentric, you can probably figure out from the word Christ-centered. So Christocentric theology is theology that puts Jesus at the center. That might sound funny to you that there would be a non-Christ-centered theology, but it happens. Christocentric reading or interpretation for me, and Robert, please jump in as well. For me, views scripture through, not just through the story of Jesus, but also sees Jesus as the culmination of that story. Like I, part of why I use that video from Bible Project is I love the visual of, right, the Old Testament ends here, and then Jesus picks up the story, right? I love that visual. I think it's so powerful. Christocentric reading wants to see the whole story of Scripture as embodied and fulfilled in Jesus, right? And we get this also from Jesus' own preaching, right? Where he says, I've come not to abolish the law or the prophets, but to fulfill them. And that distinction is important because historically too often Christians have read the New Testament in a way that says, okay, we have the New Testament now. We can just jettison the Old Testament. We can just, you know, it's kind of, sometimes it's called replacement theology. Jesus, you know, the New Testament has replaced the Old Testament. Christianity has replaced Judaism. And you can imagine, of course, how historically that has played out in all kinds of bigotry and violence by Christians against Jews. But also theologically, it's disastrous because there's no way to make sense of the story of Jesus and the story of the kingdom without all that wonderful Old Testament background and the prophets and the law and Genesis and all that. So that's really great. But to see that Jesus is the culmination of the story, right? The story was always pointing to Jesus. Now, we didn't know that, right? That's hindsight being 2020, but that Jesus really is the fulfillment of that story. That's, to me, what Christocentric interpretation means. It also means that when there's a hard question, I turn to Jesus, right? So I was talking with someone this week. There are Christians who, mostly when they talk about God, they talk about God's glory and God's power, their authority. Reformed Christianity goes this way a lot. Kind of Calvinist theology really wants to focus on the glory of God. Whereas Methodist, Arminians, we tend to talk more about God's grace and God's love. And one way I go with that is, God's glory is important, but for me, God's glory is known in God's love. Right? God's glory is suffering love revealed on the cross. God's love is washing feet. God's love is suffering and dying for one's enemies, as we see in Jesus, right? So that'd be an example maybe of Christocentric interpretation. But Robert, jump in and I'd love to see if what else you would say about that. But that's a great thought. And I think a huge interpretive help, you know, when the going gets tough, when you're reading scripture, take it back to Jesus, right? Christocentric interpretation. So cool. Thanks for the kind words, Darren. Thanks for that. It's kind of terrifying, but also exciting. So I'm glad there's still 20 people watching. So we'll take it. Any other questions? Anything else? We're on a roll. I know people have to get to lunch. So far, Brittany has not yelled at me, so I'm still okay, I think. But anything else? This is fun. And it's important because I know scripture is both, you know, the source of a lot of life, but also a lot of pain for folks. So that's why I wanted to take a little extra time if folks did have questions about this. So, all right. Anything else? We'll call it here in just a second. This has been fun. Make sure if you didn't already, your Friday email, check out the upcoming blood drive with One Blood. And also, next time you go to Target, Walmart, do your online order, whatever it is, pick up some supplies for our teachers. I want to really support the teachers here in our congregation. A lot of them are having to buy their own supplies. And, you know, with all the cleaning and stuff they have to do, that goes fast, and that stuff is not cheap. So I'm excited about the prospect of supporting our teachers in the midst of all this. So, all right, friends, seeing nothing else. We'll call this Q&A time closed, but this has been fun. If you would like me to do this again, let me know. If this has been helpful, we could do this again. But thanks so much for sticking around and asking questions. Thank you, Shannon. And I hope you all have a great day. I look forward to being with you again, either virtually or in person. We will be, by the way, we will have something in person for Ash Wednesday. I'll be sharing more about that soon. Probably look a little bit like it did for Christmas Eve. Probably primarily online, but we will have something offered in person as well, because it's Ash Wednesday and we want to do that. So, all right, y'all. God bless. Thanks for the questions. Thanks for watching and listening. If there's other questions, again, just shoot me an email or a text message. And it's been fun. Thank you so much. God bless.